This is the good sound quality video, right? So welcome to the video. I always seem to have something important enough to make a video about, and today is no exception. Last night I had a dream, and I was with Longchenpa, the great teacher Longchenpa, in this dream. Quite significant, to say the least. And so here we go, and my consciousness is reflecting this significance, and I received some advice, very good advice. And again, my consciousness is reflecting this advice. I've been going through a crisis for a while here, and I'm pushing so fast that it feels like a crisis. But now I feel that the crisis has abated somewhat after receiving this advice, really tremendous advice. And the meeting with Longchenpa was very collegial and very nice, and he was so accommodating and kind, and I just hung out with him. Sat down next to him and a little chat. And so, without trying to force anything or rush anything, there's just a massive amount of positive advice, not a mat, but very strong positive advice right now that I have. So if you can tune into this and be ready to hear this. I can't convince anyone in dialogue or discussion of it. Not in this world. This world is, I'm just a lowly assistant to a spiritual teacher, you might say. A very low bottom rung. And I cannot prevail against what I call the matriarchy, the ego matriarchy, that mindset here is too powerful. I cannot prevail against that at all. But I can offer this advice for those who are willing to consider it. And what the advice was is to say that I've decided in this life to not have any more suffering or any more turmoil or smartness. And I'm going to place all of that into a future life, a potential future life. So I say, I'm not going to entertain any more suffering, misery, learning, smartness, sickness or learning. I'm not going to entertain any more sickness or learning in the rest of this life. And any more entertaining I do of sickness and learning will be in a future life, if I choose to exercise that option. If I choose to exercise that option, it's there for me. But for this life, the rest of this life, smooth sailing. Smooth sailing. So, and then I developed this and clarified it and became more and more clear about this. This is the gist of it, just to give you, right off the bat here, the gist of it. Let me adjust this a little bit here, the lighting on this. So, I was looking, examining this advice, and just saying, wow, this is really interesting advice. I like it. I really love it. I love this advice. Very wise advice. Very pragmatic advice. And I found that, I'm not quite able to get to effortlessness right now, this life, probably, for the rest of this life. Certainly, maybe not in the next 5 months or whatever. And I would say almost everyone on this planet is in the same boat as I am. So we can't quite finish up yet. We cannot quite do it. So the finishing up, let that be in a next life or a future life, a distant life, where if there's more effort that I need to struggle with, I'll struggle with it then. I'll struggle with it then. But for the rest of this life, no struggle. No struggle. So right now, and for the rest of this life, no struggle at all. Now, Longchenpa, I saw him in the role as a manager, like a manager of a baseball team, very wise manager. I said, like in the Hall of Fame managers. There's some area where all the Hall of Fame managers were. It wasn't just him; it was many. I was in there, and I was sitting next to him. I seemed to have an affinity with Longchenpa, and we just get along. Okay, let's just put it that way. We just get along, you know. It just, there's an ease, like a comfort level of there. And so, I'm just hanging out with like this baseball manager, a really great Hall of Fame baseball manager, and they know how to manage the game. They know how to manage the game. And so, this is the advice that was transmitted to me. And I'm looking at this, I'm saying, well, that's just brilliant management of this whole situation. Just brilliant. I hadn't quite thought of it in that way. You know, but I can understand it. Yeah. I understand how this plays. What I've been trying to do is I desperately try to finish up, and it's stressing me out so bad. I'm getting rashes and stuff. I'm just so, you know, trying to finish. And the advice is, look, finish in some other life, another life, a distant life. This will do the finishing then, if you need to. If you need to. Okay, this is a wonderful burden lifted off my shoulders. And like I said, I've already dug into it and seen it, but I don't want to struggle with it right now yet. You know, I don't want to be a struggle to try to explain this. I want this just to, the gist of this to be heard. This is the advice I'm giving everyone right now. So for the rest of this life, we're free of all sickness, free of fatigue, free of all struggle, just feeling flawless, smoothed out flawless right now. Now any remaining struggle will be dealt with in a subsequent life, future life. This life, the rest of this life, will be used to be of maximum assistance to the great managers, game managers, the game of waking up from what effort. Now, I use this analogy. Some of you will resonate with this analogy. Let's say there's this beautiful, gorgeous ballroom where there's this dance taking place. And you really want to go to this dance and dance in that ultimately exquisite ballroom. But in order to dance in this ballroom, you have to dance effortlessly. So you go to where this ballroom is, and you say, I want to get in. And the head of the dance says, look, you're too awkward. You're not able yet to dance the way you need to dance, which is effortlessly. But you're still a little too awkward. You say, oh, okay, I got to get rid of this awkwardness. And you try and try and try, and you're still awkward. You say, wow, I can't make the big dance. And then you tell them your problem. You say, look, I can't make the big dance. And I'm very disappointed. I say, look, I'm really concerned because there's all these juvenile delinquents and stragglers who outside trying to get a hold of me. I'm in a disappointed mood, and they're trying to say, hey, come with us and let's go drive out into the boondocks and we'll practice being awkward, and we worship awkward dancing, and you can dance with us because we love awkward dancing. In fact, we're trying to perfect awkward dancing, so it's like automatic and no effort involved with awkward dancing. Trying to automate it, roboticize it, you know. They love the robotic awkward dancing, right? There's all these terrible juvenile delinquents, stragglers, I call them, terrible stragglers, who are not there to go to the great dance, but are there to prey upon those who are disappointed in not being able to make the dance. And I say, this is a huge problem. Can you please help me with this? I've fallen victim to this already in my life. Terrible. And the head of the dance says, absolutely. He says, we have this little dance studio attached here to the great ballroom. And you can hang out in this dance studio, and we have these great dance teachers who will teach you how to dance effortlessly. And they will, their awkwardness will evaporate. Okay, let's put it this way. They will show you how to evaporate your awkwardness so that your dancing is effortless. And then you will be able to go into the grand ballroom and dance the effortless dance there. And I said, wow, I like that. I like that opportunity. I want that opportunity. I agree to that. So this is a metaphor for what's going on right now. And I think a lot of women can relate to this metaphor. Maybe some men. Women tend to relate to the metaphor of dancing better than men. So get this metaphor and say, oh, I see the context of what's going on. Just imagine this, just the most exquisite ballroom imaginable. It is just so beautiful. And you are there, you want in, but you're too awkward still. Because you've been out in the boondocks with these stragglers teaching you how to be awkward, how to dance with tons of effort. All right, these miscreants, these stragglers, very bad stragglers. And so you can't quite evaporate this awkwardness. You keep trying, but the trying gets in the way, and you're still awkward, and it's so frustrating, and you think, oh, I failed, this is terrible. But wait a minute, hold on, not so fast. There's this beautiful dance studio, very nice, gorgeous dance studio. It's not as nice as the Grand Ballroom, but it is very, very nice indeed. And you can hang out in this ballroom, not in this dance studio, which is right attached to this Grand Ballroom. There's big door. There's an entranceway you can go through there. All right. So there's access to it. And you can hang out in this dance studio. And there's these just brilliant dance teachers there who will show you how to release your awkwardness, let it evaporate. How that's done. How we can do that. Okay. And you will get it done. It will happen for you for sure. You will then find yourself dancing in that great grand ballroom. This is an option we have. This is an option we have. This is an option we have. So exercise the option. The way to exercise the option is to say to these stragglers, miscreant juvenile delinquents who want to drag you off into the bushes, all right, and beat the stuffing out of you and make you awkward and make you engage in all these ritual, crazy magic rituals of worshiping awkwardness, okay? The idol of awkwardness. You can say to them, look, folks, I'm not going to do it for the rest of this lifetime. I'm going to be in this dance studio. But if I engage with you, it's going to be in some future life. I might engage with you, not now, but maybe later. Maybe later I'll engage with you, but it's going to be in a future life. It is not going to be in this life at all. The rest of this life, I'm going to be in this dance studio, and so that's it. Okay, this is how you have to speak to them, because this gives you the necessary leverage over these stragglers. Now, I happened to go downtown Los Gatos yesterday, first time in a long time, and walk around, and I can tell you it was terrible. It is infested with stragglers. Hideous. I wanted to get out of there so fast I couldn't stand it. Went past the Apple store, and it was hideous. I mean, it was jam-packed. I said, wow, this is a desert. This is a spiritual desert. I mean, that place is a spiritual desert, downtown Los Gatos. I advise everyone to stay away from there. A very hideous place, full of very much backwoods, boondock, awkward straggler, miscreant, juvenile delinquents, spiritual juvenile delinquents, to say the least. They're spiritual stragglers. And the weird thing was, there were police cars everywhere. It was astonishing. On every corner, parked here, massive police presence there. I said, what is going on here? It felt ominous. It felt threatening. I said, what is... Police standing in the road, talking in there, looking everywhere, talking into their... And then I asked them, I said, oh, that's that way all the time, weekends especially. Well, what are they doing? Well, they're trying to deter East Side criminals, gangsters, you know, from coming to downtown Los Gatos, because it's a tourist place, big tourist place. They want to make sure there have been some robberies of jewelry stores. So they're trying to deter. So there's a heavy, heavy police deterrence presence down there, which never used to be like that. So it is just a nasty place. It's a spiritual desert. So these are stragglers. The tech people are stragglers, okay? take this from me, even though I'm a very lowly assistant. I'm still a very lowly assistant to a really great game manager. Okay. Super Hall of Fame game manager. One of the very best of the best. But I'm a very lowly assistant. Just as low as low can be. Okay. But I do have this advice to give out. I cannot prevail in arguments and dialogue with this, okay? But I can suggest it, that these tech people are awful stragglers, spiritual stragglers. They're the ones that are way out in the boondocks. It's time to come into the barn. There's a big storm coming. And the farmer, the rancher's going out saying, getting all the cattle back into the barn. Say, come on. There's a terrible storm. But there's some that are just hiding way out in the boondocks. And they're stragglers. They don't want to come in from the storm. They're very bad stragglers. Severe spiritual delinquents. And they've infested this planet. This planet here is actually a place where delinquents, spiritual delinquents come from. It's a very low planet, actually. Now, when I decided to, okay, no more suffering, no more sickness, no more troubles for the rest of this life, and I'll put all the suffering and troubles and sickness, whatever's left for me of effort-based, I'll put it in a future life. And if I need to deal with it in a future life, I'll deal with a future life. I've had enough for this life. Enough is enough. The rest of this life is going to be flawless. When I did that, I found myself looking down from another realm at this world. And I found out that just the decision to say not now for all the suffering in a future life, not the rest of this life, that in itself is the shift. That in itself is the ascension. Wow. And I could see myself, I'm no longer in this realm of the world and all the turmoil is taking place there. I'm not in that realm. That's all reserved for a future life. If I choose to exercise that option. And we must understand that all our lives are simply our choice, whether to exercise an option to engage with effort or not. What we call the cycles of life and death are really just our own choice to exercise an option. Say, well, I want another life. I want to engage with effort because I'm curious about it. We don't have to do it. It's an option. We're not really bound by karma. We're not really bound by it. It's an option. And we have the absolutely free to say, I'm going to, if I exercise such an option, it's going to be in a future life, but I'm not exercising any that option anymore in this life. No more struggle. And I did that. I said, yeah, I can do this. And I realized that itself is the ascension. That is the shift. That's how simple it is. That's how simple it is. I've always said there is a way. And now I'm saying this is the way. This is the way. And it's so simple. My gosh, it's so brilliant. I know my life I've been struggling. Like, how do we ascend? How do we ascend? I know a lot of us have been also doing that. How do we ascend? We need to ascend. And now I'm seeing this is how we ascend, actually. This is how we ascend. And I always felt I would get to it. I would get the answer somehow. I knew I would. I just didn't know what it was. So I was like, wow, interesting conundrum, isn't it? But this is it. This is it. This is the ascension. We simply put all remaining effort that we may want to engage with into a future life. That's it. Not this one anymore. So this life smoothly ascends into a higher realm, into a more beautiful realm, where effort and turmoil is much, much less and distant. It seems very distant. It seems like an option we can exercise at a distance. It doesn't demand that we don't have a future life, so to speak. We still feel, yeah, I could exercise the option of a future life. But right now, I don't really feel like it. I'm really enjoying this higher realm. So maybe at some distant point, I might do that. But but right now I'm really just enjoying this higher realm, where there's an absence of turmoil and conflict. Now I fell asleep after I'd gone through all this a little bit, and I woke up from this dream and I saw myself in this truck, a tanker truck of some kind, like a water tanker truck. And I was driving this truck and I was getting off an off ramp to go somewhere. And I'd stopped, and then I backed up just like I did in the video a couple days ago. I was Friday video of driving where this lady had stalled out and was blocking traffic, and I was trapped. But I looked, and there was nobody behind me, and I backed up the street and got around her like that. She had run out of gas or something. And the same thing in the dream, I was on this on ramp. I think, oh, I have to go onto this on ramp. And I stopped. I said, wait a minute. And I looked, and nobody behind me. I backed up off the on ramp and then got backed on this surface street. And I saw this sign as I was, was it the name of the street or name of the city or the town I was going into? It was R-I-M-E, Rime, Rime. Well, Rime, I believe, is a movement in Tibetan Buddhism right now, an ecumenical movement which is designed to resolve all these conflicts. This is what I believe. I came across this recently, where there's some Tibetan teachers of Tibetan Buddhism. They say there's been a movement going for maybe 100 and some odd years, where let's bring all these four different or whatever different schools of Tibetan Buddhism who have been in conflict for so long and they've been battling one another. Let's see the similarities between the sameness among all of them, and let's have this ecumenical movement where there's not conflict in spiritual teaching. And I was entering into Rimeville, which meant this lack of conflict in spiritual teaching, this beautiful ecumenical feeling, which is what I feel in myself. I don't have conflict within me about these different spiritual teachings. It's all the same. They're all pointing to the vision of sameness. That's it. And all this philosophical different schools throughout history that have struggled with one another and argue with one another, none of that is necessary, actually. None of that, and we're in this higher realm, none of that arises. All struggle is displaced off into a future life if we want to exercise that option. And the vision of sameness is right now. Very, very profound information here. But those of you who are still watching these videos, you absolutely deserve this information. Everybody deserves it. But those who are still watching these videos, you should realize that this is information is being shared here. This is very, very helpful, profound information. But again, I cannot prevail against this world. I realize that. But I can give out this information for what it's worth. Buffalo Springfield, for what it's worth. I can give it out for what it's worth, but I certainly cannot prevail against the stubbornness of this world and the argumentative nature, conflict nature, turmoil nature of this world. Again, I'm just a lowly scrub. Yeah. But at least I know how to ascend. Okay. But knowing how to ascend doesn't mean you're some great spiritual master. It does not mean that. It does not mean that. I'm just a very lowest of bottom rung assistant. I'm a bottom rung assistant. But I do know how to ascend. So Jesus, as Jesus said, even the lowest in the kingdom of heaven is greater than the greatest in the kingdom of darkness, the kingdom of the ego. But that doesn't mean that while here in this world that they can necessarily prevail here. It does not mean that. the curiosity with delay is very intense here. So you really have to be very high up in spiritual familiarity to be able to prevail here in this world the way like a Ramana Maharshi or Ananda Maima did, for instance, like that, or a Jesus or a Longchamp. You have to be very, very, very high up indeed in your familiarity and acceptance. You have to know how to manage the game. You have to be a great game manager, an effortless great game manager. So I'm not that, and I won't be that for the remainder of this life. Absolutely not. I won't be a great game manager, but I can be a lowly assistant. I can be a lowly assistant to these teachers, for example, Longchenpa, who I seem to have an easy affinity for. I just like the way he manages the game. I just like it. Yeah, it's just a few words, but it works for me. It works very well for me. There's very little baggage. You see, there's no baggage associated with him. With me, there's no baggage associated. Historical baggage, really. No. He's just the one. He's just very, just, I just take him as he is. Met him as he is. I didn't have any preconceived notion of never even knew about him or heard about him, nothing. And so I thought, oh, I like this. I like this attitude here. And that's it. Don't have to go through any tradition to relate. It's just direct relating. This is the directness. So my meeting with Longchenpa was direct meeting, not through any Buddhist tradition whatsoever. It was just simply a direct meeting, which is, you know, refreshing. Very refreshing. So whatever he did, Buddha, I don't care. My meeting with him was direct. And he just, how was the trip? How was the ocean? It's neither warm nor, it's both warm and cold. It's both warm and cool, both. That's both ways, yeah. It's just like, wow. He didn't lay a bunch of Buddhist teaching upon me, really. Or anything like that. I mean, I read the book Spaciousness, but that doesn't really lay so much teaching on me. It's direct teaching. It's saying, yeah, all this Buddhist stuff you're doing, okay, the gradualist approach, yeah, but listen to this. Listen to what I have to say. The awesome investiture of the now. Let's talk about that. I say, oh, that's music to my ears. Let's just talk about that. That's all he's interested in, you see? He's not really attached to gradualism, all the gradualistic endeavor of this world. He's not. He's saying, look, that's really spinning your wheels. Let's talk about the awesome investiture of the now. For everything that arises is merely decoration of its own intrinsic spaciousness. Let's just talk about that and nothing else. So I say, yeah. So I'm not going to get a bunch of other extraneous talk from him, you know, about other stuff. That's all he's interested in. Along with great game advice, great how to manage the game here. Let's put all remaining struggle in a future life, right now. Let's do that right now. Let's do it right now. As I have said before, let's start our next life right now. Well, we can refine that, and let's put all remaining struggle into a future life right now. This is even better advice. So you might say, well, let's start the rest of our life right now, which will be problem-free, struggle-free. Let's start the struggle-free continuum of this life right now. I would say that's even clearer advice. And we've got the future Steph Curry's there practicing basketball. It's a nice soundtrack. Steph Curry, He shoots it from half court. I got the clock's running out. Let me heave up a shot. Three-quarter court from three quarters. You know, boom. Makes it. Oh, but it was too late. Next time up the court. It's ready. Time's running out of the half. Let me shoot it from half court. Boom. Makes that one too. Everybody's going like, are you kidding me? Yeah, it's going in. We know it's going in. So all these little kids say, hey, I wanna do that too. It's kinda cool to just wherever you shoot from, you know it's going in. Doesn't matter where it's from. Distance doesn't matter. But I've been there and done that, done my basketball thing. For me, I want to be like Rick Barry. Play like Rick Barry, the great Hall of Famer Rick Barry. Just super creative. Great basketball player, one of the all-time best. Just such a great shooter, but so creative. Just everything, had everything. Dribbling, passing, court awareness, circus shots, the whole thing. That's how I played. I played like Rick Barry. I couldn't play like Jordan. That was later. I wasn't playing basketball anymore. Because, you know, I didn't have that sort of game. The power jam game. Power jam game. Come fly with me. Couldn't fly like that. Yeah. And now they have these younger generation, Curry guys, who has this great game, super game, kind of a smaller Rick Barry, but with better range, better shooting ability. Yeah. So, we've just been given the keys to ascension here. And we're just like, okay, wow. Which is what I've been asking for. You know, I've been praying for this. And son of a gun, right? Hey, Holy Spirit responded, answered my prayer. Now, how does it all work? Well, the Holy Spirit is the grace of God. Okay, so there's God the Father, which is the totality, all it is. The grace of God is what we call the Holy Spirit. And the grace of God really is in charge of help freeing us from the delusion of time, from our valuing of time. Okay? That's what it's totally in charge. It's flawlessly in charge, perfectly in charge of all that. This is the Holy Spirit. Now, the Holy Spirit uses emanations. Okay, so the highest emanation would be like a Jesus Christ or a Buddha, for instance. These are emanations of the Holy Spirit, the grace of the Holy Spirit. And Ananda Mahima would be an emanation of the Holy Spirit. A Manjushri, a Bodhisattva, high Bodhisattva, would be then an emanation of these high emanations, like a Buddha. For instance, in Buddhist tradition, Manjushri is a emanation of Buddha, clarity, wisdom, emanation of Buddha. So it goes Holy Spirit, then below that is the highest emanations, highest activity, like a Jesus or a Buddha, for instance. And then beneath them would be like the great Bodhisattvas, or in the Christian tradition, the great archangels. Okay, the great archangels would be, you know, serving Jesus. They're emanations of Jesus' grace. For instance, Manjushri be an emanation of Buddha's grace. And then from there would be an appearance in this world such as a Longchenpa. Okay, for instance, great saints, sages, gurus. Rarely do the high emanations appear like a Buddha, a Jesus, Ananda Mahima, like that. They rarely appear, but they can appear here too. But these emanations of these bodhisattvas or archangels can appear. And that would be like a Longchenpa would appear. He's an emanation of Manjushri, this super high bodhisattva or archangel, you might say. And then these great teachers here, like Longchenpa, they have devotees who can hear, they have assistants. And those assistants are like apostles, like in Christian terminology. Jesus had assistants, right? Those are were the apostles. Jesus the Christ was an emanation of Christ. Just like Shakyamuni, Buddha was an emanation of Buddha mind. Okay, very, very, very high. So these apostles of Jesus were assistants of Jesus. And the assistants are just assistants. Jesus himself said, look, you guys really don't understand me very well at all. You don't know how to manage the game like I do. Just accept it, your assistance. And they struggle like with that. And so yeah, assistants can give assistance, and they gradually get more and more familiar with it, and they become more helpful. So I'm just a lowly assistant, the bottom of the barrel, bottom rung assistant, you might say. But again, even a bottom-rung assistant knows how to ascend, apparently. Now, assistant has access to the teacher, like a Longchenpa. And again, it goes, so assistant, guru, bodhisattva, Buddha mind, Christ mind, Holy Spirit, God. That's how it goes, like that. So I'm like the fifth level. I go, God is one, Holy Spirit two, top emanations three, then these great teachers four, and then their assistants five. Five, so I'd be at the fifth level. Fifth level, the lowest level. So we can, but the lowest level is in touch with the great teachers here, the great teachers that have been here, like, you know, Rama Maharshi. I've met Rama Maharshi, met Nandamayi Ma, met Jesus Christ. I've met these teachers, met Longchenpa. And the opportunity to be assistant was raised to me. He says, how would you like to be an assistant? And I said, wow, I don't know if I can do that or not. So let me consider it. So I've just been working at it to see if I can make the grade. And I'm trying to function as a lowly assistant at this point by giving out ascension advice, giving out the advice that I received. That's pretty much what assistants do. They get the right advice, and then they share it with others. They don't argue with others. I'm not trying to establish that I'm some master or guru. That's not my role. My role is not to argue with others or discuss or anything like that and convince. My role is not to convince. Not to have this great debate, and if I win the debate, then everybody has to follow what I say. This is part of the lore of history. It's blah blah blah. That's not my role. I'm a lowly assistant. My role is just to give out this advice to those who have ears to hear it. That's it. I'm not here to struggle. Let the great teachers and great emanations do that if they want to. That's they need to. Those who know how to manage the game, the big game, they're the ones who have to do something like that. You know, Adi Shankara said to have engaged in a debate and won the debate, and then that it had then had access to be able to change the structuring of the Dharma, etc. How, you know, how it was pursued, and well, you know, he was a great emanation, and understood the game, the whole game. All right, all the subtleties, the big game. All right, whatever. I'm not that. I'm not that at all. Not pretending to be that at all. Never have. Never haven't. So, but I am a lowly assistant. I will say that. I'm a lowly assistant. I'm taking on that responsibility simply by doing it. But, you know, that's other stuff's above my pay grade, to say the least. But even a lowly assistant is greater than the greatest egotist, you know, right? Who's serving the ego, serving this search, this delay really is all it is. It's just delay, serving delay. So I'll put my education up against anyone in this world right now. Okay, right here, right now. I'll put up against anyone. Because the education to be an assistant to one of these great teachers is very strenuous, to say the least. And I know how to ascend, you know, so that's a pretty good education right there. So I'll put my education up against anyone. And of course, these great teachers will gracefully decline the invitation, where the egotist might say, oh, you know, I got a great education too. I'll put up against any egotist, my education up against any egotist, right here, right now, this instant. Okay. It's been quite an education. So, I'm not under any authority of any egotist here, really. I cannot prevail against them decisively at all, no. I understand that. You know, I can't prevail against the matriarchy, for instance, not at all. I can sidestep it. I'll try to, certainly. Just like I had that experience, I had a very dramatic experience in this dead-end place, this completely dead-end block place with a concrete barrier, the store, and the backwater, you know, it was hard to even find the place. I was just, wow, there was no way out. I said, no exit here, you know, and this freeway here is blocked, and there's a way to get into it, but it was circuitous. And then this woman again came in, this out of her mind as far as on drugs, just completely messed up. And I had this very dramatic encounter there where I decided this is too much trouble for me to deal with. I could not prevail against this mindset. I did not have the capacity to. And so I took refuge in the shop. I took refuge away so she couldn't find me. I don't want to be found by that. It's too much trouble. So I understood where I stood. I accepted my lowly stature, you know, and I was pragmatic about it, which was a very good test, passed the test. Discretion is the better part of valor. It really is. Discretion is the better part of valor, okay? This is very important to understand. We have to be humble here and know where we stand. And I can say this, that most of us here in this world, the very highest we're going to reach is a very low bottom rung of an assistant. That's the very highest any of us are going to reach here. And that bottom rung assistant is not able to prevail against the matriarchy here at this time. Maybe some future life I'll be able to, but not now. Too much trouble. And that is... meaning, matriarchy means trying to spiritualize delay, trying to spiritualize delay, make this house of delay a home. And again, it's very important to point out, just because you happen to have an appearance here as a female body appearance, in no way does that mean that you have to accept the matriarchy. The matriarchy lies to everyone and says, look, you're a woman, you have to do what we say. It's inherent within you. That is an atrocious lie. It is absolutely not true. Women are able to be lowly assistants of spiritual teachers also. They can make that grade also. No way do they have to automatically serve the matriarchy. Just like men don't automatically have to serve the matriarchy either. It's a decision Because, well, we're curious about delay. Say, maybe if we spiritualize delay, how is that? We're curious about that. I wonder what spiritualizing delay is like. Well, we already know what it's like. It's the history of this planet. Spiritualizing delay. We already know what it's like. Ananda Mayama helped me with that a lot. She says, let's go through this whole thing about spiritualizing delay, and I'll help you do that and see what it's like. And so I did that. I did all sorts of stuff of spiritualizing delay, and I experienced this. So she was like super helpful for me. But I don't want to do it anymore. So I kind of want to stay away from her because I might get back into it. You know, that's the function that she provided for me as a great grace. And I went through the whole goddess thing, and the flowers, and the dressing up, and the spiritualization of delay, and how we make it so glamorous and so beautiful, and have these beautiful pictures, and worship this, and the songs, everything. I went through the whole thing, and I felt how it felt. So you have to say that Sri Sri Ananda Mayama was instrumental in where I am right now, is being able to be at least a very lowly assistant, the lowest of low assistants to a spiritual teacher. Very instrumental in it. But I'm not serving her in particular, okay? It seems to be that I'm serving Longchenpa as a lowly assistant. I'm not serving Jesus either, it seems like, or Ram Maharshi. They played instrumental roles. But the one that I seem to be at ease, most at ease with, is Longchenpa. And in Ecumenicalville, this is all understood. It's not like they're put out, like an Ananda Mayama go, hey, I wanted you to serve me, what's the matter with you? Not at all. She knew. She knew that she was helping me get ready to serve some teacher, right? Same with Jesus. Same with Jesus. Same with Jesus. Same with Ram Maharshi. They all are perfectly aware of this. It's all one grace coming from the Holy Spirit, which comes from God. It's all one grace. Okay, so it's all pragmatic. The Holy Spirit is totally pragmatic. So, based on our own uniqueness, what's the best fit? That's all there. Like, you know, a great CEO, management CEO, puts people in the right places. Where do you fit in? What's the best fit for you? They're not all hung up on the ego, say, you got to be my assistant. They say, now, where would you fit in best? That's all they're concerned about. Now, for me, there's no glamour in serving Longchenpa. Oh, I don't have any image or association or anything like that of him at all. It doesn't seem glamorous to me at all. Whereas, like, serving Jesus would have a certain glamour to it. You know, there's some baggage there. Like, well, I'm serving Jesus. Wow, you're really high up there. Oh my gosh, you know, it's extraordinary. And for me, Longchenpa is just that. You know, just doesn't really ring any bells of glamour at all to me. And maybe some Tibetan Buddhists say, oh my God, you're serving like the Longchenpa and Manjushri, this is incredible. But for me, I don't feel that way. I don't feel that way at all. Now maybe somebody from Buddhism or something, Hinduism or whatever, might be serving Jesus, and Christians might say, oh my gosh, you're apostles of Jesus, you're serving Jesus. Oh my gosh, that's unbelievable. This is just, it's amazing. It's just super glamorous, my gosh. And they'd just say, what are you talking about? I don't feel that way at all. He's just a, you know, great bodhisattva, but I don't have any glamour there. So that's helpful. This is how it works. Now, I have a pretty good golf swing right now, actually. Very interesting. I've found a swing. I found a swing. I've been working so intensely on it. And it's... You wouldn't think it's a powerful swing, but the swing speed is there. It's very interesting. It's not a full swing, actually. But I'm still able to deliver tremendous speed with it, but it's not the full swing. So that's kind of like an assistance, a lowly assistance swing. But it seems to be I haven't used it yet on actually hitting a ball, but just from knowing a lot about the swing now, I realize, it's a very simple swing. Very simple, very direct, and yet I'm still able to generate, because my core is much stronger now, I'm still able to generate a great deal of power with the swing. Maybe not complete maxed out power, but a lot of power. Enough to move the ball down the fairway. And that new driver, well, it's a used driver, but it looks new. I haven't hit a golf ball with it yet, but, and I don't believe I will this today either. It's still kind of cold, and the funds have not, arrived in some way. So I really might not be able to play today either. But it does, just the club and looking at it, it's just fabulous. I mean, this is a club that like a pro would have. It really is. Or a really good amateur, you might say, or a lowly pro. Say a lowly pro would have this sort of golf club. The shaft is the best shaft really there is, basically. I mean, it's up there in the highest of high echelons, and the club head also the same thing. I mean, it's just a great, the grip, everything. It is pro caliber. This golf club is pro caliber. And I say, okay, I'll put it in my bag. The Holy Spirit told me to do this. And I said, well, I'm not that good. He said, well, you will be. You're ready for that. Good enough to hit it down the fairway, right? And that's what a lowly assistant is good enough. I'm just good enough to hit it down the fairway. I'm not a touring pro. I'm not Jordan Spieth. I'm just a little wannabe Jordan Spieth. Or Rory McIlroy, or, whoever, the top guns of the day, Jason Day. Ricky Fowler, Bubba Watson, whatever. These are the guys of today. I'm not one of those. I'm not even on the tour, but I'm able to move it down the fairway. So I'm a lowly assistant, a very lowly assistant, the lowest type of assistant is what I am right now. And for the rest of this life, I will likely be just that. But I do know how to ascend. I do know how to ascend, which is great information to share. And that is, again, just simply decide that all struggle, all remaining struggle that you may choose to engage with, you're going to engage with it in a future life, not this one anymore. That is ascension right there. It's that simple. So I'm not going to put myself under the gun and say, am I going to ascend or not? I am saying I certainly do know how to ascend. Okay. But I'm not going to say whether I might or I might not. I'm not going to put myself under the gun of that. But I do know how to ascend. So I can share this advice. And you can start considering, like, hey, maybe I might want to ascend too. Maybe I'll ascend, but you don't have to commit to it. Say, yeah, hey, everybody, I'm definitely going to ascend. We can practice, and I can ascend, I will ascend, I've already ascended. We can practice it. We can practice ascension, sure, but I'm not going to guarantee, it's not my place as a lowly assistant, the lowest assistant, to guarantee that I will ascend. That's not my place to do that, because then you're getting in the face of the matriarchy, the egoic goddess, mother goddess, matriarchy, delay complex, and that's not my place to get in their face. Because I'm not going to prevail in such a situation. I understand that. I accept that. So I'm not guaranteeing my ascension, but I do say I do know how to ascend, and I can share this advice with you. Absolutely. So, for what it's worth. Well, something's happening here. What it is ain't exactly clear. Right. Yeah. This world, the turmoil. Right. They're talking about the turmoil. All right. Yeah. Turmoil, this world. So, what is today? It is the 24th of January, and this ascension advice of how to ascend, what ascension is given out to the world on the 24th of January, 2016. exactly what, 5 months from deadline, which is July 24th, right? I believe that's what I have said before. I'll have to double check that. I believe I said something like that. In February, March, April, May, June, July. It's exactly 6 months. 6 months. 6 months to the drop dead date that we have, where I believe we must be committed. This is the year of commitment. Okay. The word for this year, just one word is all you need to remember about this year. Just one word. We're that simple now, and that's commitment. 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 So we need to be committed to ascension. I'm committed. Now, whether we're going to ascend or not, we don't need to say. We don't need to say. Whether we actually will, the fact that we're committed to it doesn't automatically mean that we will. But we're certainly going to try. Okay? We're certainly going to try. Yeah. I'm not saying I will or will succeed. We know how to now. We know how to do it. We absolutely do know how to do it. Now we might say, well, you know, I'm a little bit too much fear. I don't know. I'm sure. But we may not. We might say, you know, we've evaporated enough continuity fear around it. So yeah, piece of cake. Piece of Cakeville, Arizona. You know, no problem. I noticed a friend wasn't working at a place anymore. He said, hey, wait, have you seen so-and-so? They said, oh, he moved to Arizona. I said, what? He said he was going to move to Washington. He said, no, he moved to Arizona. I said, wow. Because in the dream that I had, we fled the turmoil of this world to Arizona. Interesting. A rezone. A-R-I stands for, I'm not sure what the remake, R-I, reduced interest in reduced interest in minimal effort, or reduced intensity minimal effort, the area of reduced intensity, something like that. It stands for, anyway, a rezone, reduced intensity of effort zone. Reduced intensity of my effort. It's a zone. So Arizona stands for a higher realm where there's a reduced intensity of my effort. Of making effort. Reduced intensity of making effort. R-I-M-E. Also stands for that. Where the effort is put into a future life that you're not engaging with yet. Okay. So that's what Arizona stands for. Now we can get ready for Arizona, for this higher realm, by dwelling in places here where there's reduced turmoil, where it's very laid back and very relaxed and reduced turmoil. It's very beautiful. I had this experience of actually experiencing the future and fleeing to Arizona, and I was welcome there, very welcome there, and I was sort of surprised by that. And I said, do you understand why I'm here? He said, oh yeah. He said, this world, I'm fleeing this world of terrible turmoil. I said, yeah, we know all about that. We've prepared that for refugees here, and you're very welcome here, and enjoy. And I felt this tremendous hospitality there. Fabulous hospitality. It's very important to experience great hospitality right now, okay? It's very important to go somewhere and experience great hospitality. It's very important. I experienced that in the desert of California recently on the last vacation. I went there and it was like the flawless hospitality. The hospitality was flawless. It was flawless. There wasn't a single mistake made It was absolutely 100% flawless. It was, it was just wow, is all I can say. We were treated like royalty. Seriously, we were treated as good as the President of the United States or President of China or whatever would be treated. If not better. Because there wasn't this kind of tenseness about being some bigwig. You know, it just, everybody was just fabulous. And the grounds and the was just extraordinarily beautiful. Everything was in immaculate condition. I just wandered around. I just said, wow, this is just amazing. This was a precursor experience to ascension, to a higher realm. And the hospitality we received there, ascension to Arizona. Arizonaville. A reduced intensity of making effort. A reduced intensity of making effort, right? Where we're able to see whatever effort we still think we may want to engage with is then seen as in a future life, but not right now. In a future life, but not right now. We're not engaging with the lower realms of effort right now. Maybe in the future life we will. This is this realm. And everything, all spirituality is ecumenical there. Totally ecumenical, right? There's no spiritual conflicts there. And we see the terrible spiritual conflicts in this world among, right, various factions. Within certain religions, there's battles within that religion. There's battles of one religion, you know, going after others. Within Islam, there's these terrible struggles taking place. Within Tibetan Buddhism, there's actually quite a bit of struggles taking place. Okay, and have been historically. Within Christianity, there's a lot of ferment also about trying to change Christianity and make it more secular humanist. So actually, there's a big struggle within, like Catholicism, there's some that simply say this pope is the anti-pope. And there's others who think he's the greatest thing that since sliced bread, which are mostly non-Catholics saying that, actually. Humanists are saying that, which is a red flag. But there's a huge struggle and turmoil there. I can tell you this. It's been maybe beneath the surface, but I get very adamant about this because, of course, my tradition is Christian tradition in terms of historically, a lot of Christian historically. So I care a lot about it, and I don't like what I'm seeing. That's neither here nor there at this point. What I'm saying is that there is all this turmoil. Well, in Arizonaville, there's no turmoil like that. There's just this perfect ecumenicalness that all effort and turmoil, though we've all decided we'll put this into a future life, but we're not experiencing any of that right now. We're not experiencing any of that right now. Everyone in there is not experiencing any of that turmoil at all right now. This is how that you ascend to this higher realm. This is how we ascend, by making that choice. Yeah, I don't want another life, but if I do have another life, that's where I'll experience the turmoil. Whatever curiosity I have left will be in a future life, but not right now. Get this? But not right now. But not right now. So it's very helpful to go somewhere and experience this hospitality. And I've already experienced that. I've got a very good taste of it, so I can tell you this is very helpful. Now, where do you go for that? Well, that's the question, right? The Holy Spirit has to guide you in that. I know where I can go, but then maybe, you know, it's not everyone's cup of tea, and the people live all around the world, and... But, you know, this is a place where it doesn't matter who you are. They treat you like you're the king of the world. And no questions asked. No questions asked. No one looking over your shoulder. No heavy police presence there like in downtown Los Gatos, which is an anathema now. Terrible place. I know they're trying to keep criminals out, and I understand that. But that's not my cup of tea right now. This is not what we want to experience. Nothing against the police. I absolutely respect and understand the job they're doing. It's very difficult. And they just are trying to keep this place safe for so tourists keep coming. If there's a bunch of crime there, the tourism will stop. And tourism is the lifeblood of downtown. Well-heeled tourists. These people are very wealthy people from all over the world come there. And they don't want, they're happy to see the police there. Yeah, but where we go to this welcoming place, there should be no need for police at all. The whole place is so peaceful, and everyone is high caliber. You go there, and it's a very peaceful place. In fact, I never saw any security at all. I just wandered. Nobody asked me any questions. In fact, wherever I was, people would smile and say, "Hey, good morning. How are you? Great." Very friendly, very nice. Like I own the place. They treated me like I was the owner of the place. You don't ask the owner of the place, "What are you doing here?" You know, it's like they really did. I was treated like I owned the place. And so I bought in. I felt like I had a part ownership of the place. You see? So I care about the place because I feel like I'm treated like I'm a part owner of the place. Like that. It's like that. This is like the higher realm. It's like you feel you are part owner of this place. You have a stake in it. You have a very important stake in it. So in this dream, I experienced my future. I was just, wow, it was so beautiful. It's more beautiful than the most beautiful resort in this world. By far. The whole place is like that. And there's no turmoil. And there's no crime, and there's no sickness, and there's no suffering, and there's no effort. Everything feels full of grace, smooth and full of grace. And there's no conflict, it's all ecumenical, smooth and full of grace. And again, how do we ascend? By deciding right now, I'm no more struggle, no more effort. Whatever effort I need to make, whatever effort I feel I need to make is going to be, all of that is going to be done in a future life. Or lives, but not with this life anymore. That is the ascension attitude. That's it. That is ascension. That's how we do it. We have to exercise this option. Practice and exercise it for sure. So we're all about focusing on ascension. We already understand this world is a world of turmoil. That's what it is. Those who are curious about effort, this is the realm. This is the what they've projected to experience this effort. Lack of grace, absence of grace. This is where they go. So they experience great turmoil and also blame the futility they feel on catastrophe. It's a very catastrophic place, this world. Very catastrophic. Inherently so, because they need a scapegoat. They did say, "Well, I failed. I feel futility because of this catastrophe, not because finding an absence of totality is impossible." They say, "No, it's possible. I just got interrupted. I couldn't find it because of this catastrophe." So catastrophes happen here. They most certainly do, along with of all sorts. Just the invasion of these stragglers is a terrible catastrophe here. The invasion of high technology is a terrible catastrophe here. Maybe worse than getting hit by an asteroid, you might say, actually. That would be the cherry on top, really. I mean, there's already a ton of catastrophes taking place here. The terrorism, global terrorism, is a catastrophe here, okay? It really is. It's creating a climate of severe fear here. It's a very bad catastrophe. secular humanism is a terrible catastrophe here. Materialism, terrible catastrophe. You know, there's many terrible catastrophes, and the conflict in the Middle East, the tensions there, is a terrible catastrophe. The tensions like between India and Pakistan is a terrible catastrophe. The various tensions, the global geopolitical tensions are terrible catastrophes here. Very, very heavy fear-based stuff. But the smartphone thing is the worst catastrophe yet in this world. No question about it. Number one, the worst catastrophe in the world is the smartphone. That's why I say boycott the smartphone. Boycott shopping in stores. Boycott that. Boycott the smartphone. Boycott politics. Boycott the news. Boycott movies. Boycott television. Previously, the worst catastrophe was movies and then television. And now it's the smartphone. It's computer and then the smartphone. We use the computer here to get the message out, so you might say there is just minimal right use of it. Okay, right use of this. I'm pragmatic. I'm not an ideologue. I'm functioning the pragmatic way. Okay, but definitely you don't really need a smartphone. You don't really need it. If you need to get in touch with somebody, just use a flip phone. Just use a go phone. That's what I use, just a go phone. No contract, just a go phone. Which, do I have it with me? Yeah. I do. Okay. Let's see. Let me take it. Alright. Just use a little go phone. AT&T go phone is what I have. Just that. Just that. Just that. Yeah. Yeah, flip it open like that. Okay. Alright. Flip it open. Flip it closed. Put it away. And that's it. And that's it. And that's it. You need to call someone, you call them. You receive a call, you receive a call. If you need to text, you can text. You need to receive a text, you text. That's it. Now, what if you have a smartphone? What do you do? Minimize it. Minimize it. Minimize it. Listen to these videos. Listen to Ascension. But minimize it. But the temptation is there, isn't it? It's very severe. So avoiding temptation is very important. There's all sorts of boycott Apple products. Boycott Apple, that corporation, as a symbol of boycotting technology. Boycott Apple. Definitely boycott Apple. They're the worst of the bunch, really. Although we haven't seen what Google's ultimately going to do. With their roboticism, they may turn out to be the worst of the bunch. But at this point, let's boycott Apple. Boycott Apple, boycott the news, boycott politics, boycott television, movies, and above all else, boycott the smartphone. You say, what do I do? What do I do? Go play golf. Go play golf. Go to a golf resort. You don't even have to play golf. Just go to a really nice golf resort. You see, the people there, they treat everybody with respect. Golfers are usually pretty well behaved. Everyone, they're treated like an adult. You're really treated well. Go to a really like top-notch golf resort and just hang out there, spend some time there. Even if you don't golf, just walk around. This is very helpful. Don't spend time looking at the smartphone all the time like that. No. Oh, if you do have a smartphone, you can take videos of the beautiful scenery and the peacefulness. And watch those, okay? So this is smart, just being a genius. Be a genius. Put together, take beautiful pictures, put together a montage. But again, try to minimize it. Boycott Facebook. Facebook is become an abomination, really, where your friends, you end up seeing everything that your friends like plus their friends likes. I say, wait a minute, I didn't friend this person. And there's no way to shut it off. So I decided to heck with Facebook. It's just horrible. I went on Facebook yesterday, tried to say, can I use this thing? It's just horrible. Boycott Facebook if you want to do that. Really, seriously, it is. You talk about betrayal. The whole idea of friends is you say, I want to share content back and forth with this person because they're on the same wavelength. But now you end up sharing content with this your friend's friends that you didn't friend at all, which completely betrays the whole purpose of Facebook. So you talk about it, well, what do you expect from those people, right? What do you expect from those folks, right? History of betrayal, history of sleaziness, Facebook, very severe history of betrayal and sleaziness. Boycott Facebook, boycott Apple, boycott Facebook. We're giving Google a kiss still because of YouTube, okay? they're allowing these videos here, so... And again, we're pragmatists here. We're pragmatists, okay? We're not out. We're not after anyone. So we're pragmatists, but we do need to take a stand. Taking a stand is pragmatic. So start boycotting stuff. Boycott the news, especially, because where we're going, there's no turmoil at all. How do you get ready for no turmoil? By focusing on turmoil. How do you do that? You don't. It's a recipe for not ascending. Okay, ascension is to a higher realm where there's no turmoil. There's no death either there. Okay? There's no death there either. If we want to die, we'll do that in a future life. Okay? That too is in a future life. If we're still curious about death and suffering and sickness and effort, if we're still curious about that, we'll do that in a future life. But right now, there's no death. There's no aging. There's no sickness. There's no suffering, misery, conflict, turmoil, none of that. So how do we get ready for such a realm? By focusing on the news. You know, and the answer is a rhetorical question. Is of course, you don't. So you need to boycott the news. Very important. This is preparation for ascension. Is part of that, is these boycotts, actually. Boycott the television, movies. I'm pretty much boycotting television. What am I boycotting? I'm boycotting the news for sure. I'm on all intents and purposes, boycotting television. I'm watching almost nothing now. I watch maybe a few minutes of a Warriors basketball game, but I may cut that out entirely now, too. So that would be like no television at all. I'm basically boycotting the internet except for this, and I check the weather. And a few sports, baseball or something, but I'm close to full boycott of internet, the internet. Okay, so news, television, internet. I certainly have been boycotting movies for about 20 years. All right, so. Oh, I'm losing track. I'm boycotting so much. News, internet, television, movies. Okay. Boycotting Apple. Certainly boycotting Apple. Boycotting politics. I'm boycotting politics. I've already done all these boycotts. I'm already doing all these boycotts. Boycotting shopping, Boycott shopping malls. Boycott shopping malls. Absolutely boycott shopping malls. I've been doing that for quite some time, about 15, maybe about almost 15 years or so. Maybe about, let's say, 12 or so. But yeah, no, maybe 15. I say 15 years. I've been boycotting shopping malls, and boycott going into stores too. That's part of the overall shopping boycott. So I'm already engaged in at least 7 major boycotts, and probably a lot more. This is being just a very pragmatic, very, not smart, but pragmatic. Pragmatism trumps smartness, very much so. It's a much higher skill than just being smart, way higher. It comes from spiritual grace, being a supreme pragmatist in this way, knowing what to boycott and when to do it. It's very, very important information. So those 7 boycotts right there, how are you doing on those boycotts? Wow. Boycott sex, boycott drugs, boycott rock and roll, so to speak, but to a large extent in music. Okay, music is a tough one for people, so being pragmatic, I say, okay, if you can listen to music, listen to, I put the playlist up for 1969 in a previous video. Maybe I'll include it in this one too. Maybe they'll be part of what I include, because I understand from a pragmatic standpoint, it's maybe the most difficult boycott of all is music, which I've been able to do, actually. But it is difficult. Probably the most difficult. So manage that wisely. Manage it wisely. Be careful of music. It's very potent. It's very bad, nasty hook to it. The sensibilities of 1969, for instance. Going back to 68, too. We can go back to 69, 68. Listening to that, it doesn't hook us into this modern. It actually warns us about this modern situation we're in. The music of 69 was very prophetic, very much so, warning us about what's to come. Said, you know, trouble, 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 trouble. I mean, Led Zeppelin. There's this, you know, here comes this Led Zeppelin into the world. Led Zeppelin was seemingly very misogynistic with some of their lyrics, but they listened to it. There's a warning us of here what's coming. This Led Zeppelin is coming, bursting into flame and crashing. And they started being very popular in 1969, 70. The playlist I have in 1969, those are the songs that were released on either singles or albums in 1969. They may have not become hits until 1970 or even later, actually. But they were released in 1969. They didn't necessarily go to the top of the charts in 69. So manage your music wisely. I think a full boycott of music is probably asking too much for most people, okay? The other stuff you can do, the 9 boycotts mentioned. The 10th one, manage it very carefully. You can have that one little vice, but manage it very carefully. Music. Music tends to hook us into all the other vices. That's a problem. So certainly reject the music of go back to 1969. Don't listen to anything past 69. Might be a good advice. Not even Blondie. You're right. Okay. Which was probably the last great band. Don't listen to any music after 1969. All right, this is what I would say. Boycott all music after 1969. So let's leave it that way. Boycott all music after 1969. Okay, so this is advice from a very lowly assistant, the lowest level of assistant of a great spiritual teacher. This is advice that I would be passing on. And I'm following this advice. I'm following this advice. This is advice that I have been following. And it got me to the point of getting advice about ascension, right advice about how to ascend. So it must be doing very good work. And I'm working my way in. Maybe I'm in a probationary role as an assistant or something, in this sort of apprenticeship to be an assistant, or maybe I'm assistant, or maybe I'm just an apprenticeship to be assistant. I don't know exactly how it works. But it got me into this situation where I'm able to hang out with a great spiritual teacher. So these boycotts are part of something that's been quite successful in my case. And again, that's pretty much the highest success anyone is going to reach in this world right now, is to be reached lowest level of an assistant to a great teacher. That's the highest achievement. And it seems as though I may have reached that highest achievement. It's possible. Yeah, I don't want to pin myself down here and say I have or I haven't. But it seems like it to me that I may have done that. Reached the highest achievement that is reasonable, pragmatically reasonable, given the times of this world, etc. Okay. Now there might be a few who have been assistants in the past who reach level of being a true spiritual master. Maybe a few of those in the world, but from a pragmatic standpoint, giving out advice, I would say for all the rest of us, the highest we can reach is the first, first lowest realm of lowest assistant of a spiritual teacher. But we can do that. I believe I have done that. And so certainly you want to trend in that direction, and you certainly want to trend in the direction of ascension. Now, I don't know if you need to be an assistant of a spiritual master to ascend. I don't know if you need to be that, really. You may just be an apprenticeship towards that. Maybe you can ascend. I don't know the answer to that. But I would just guess at it. You don't have to reach that achievement to ascend. No, you don't have to. But I could reconfigure that later if I need to, that statement. I'm not positive about that. It's an interesting question. But ascension is merely just deciding that whatever effort and struggle and turmoil and sickness and death and all that, whatever engagement that you may still want to have with that, is all of that is going to be pushed back to a future life. You're not going to do any of it in this life anymore. That's it. That's ascension. That's the ascension attitude. And when you fully accept this and decide and agree to it, then at the appropriate time, you will be ascended. You will be ascended. And you might even still be here for a while. I don't know how that works. That may be optional, to have an appearance here, still have an appearance there or not. It's still cold. It's still not really golf weather, really. It's not at all. I'm waiting for the golf weather. It's supposed to be some this week. I'm under a lot of pressure from the world, from the matriarchy, etc. Really, the egoic delay, curiosity about delay. Like, how much power can we have in delay? Well, is delay really a power? It's not. Is it really a power? Is futility really a power? No, it's not any real empowerment. There's no other self being empowered by delay. That's not coming from some, delay is not coming from some other self that has the power of delay. It's all just pretense. Is pretense really power over the one pretending? Of course not. But we're curious about it. That curiosity keeps playing out in this lower realm. This world really is a very low realm. Very low indeed. It's a backwater, it's a boondocks, backwater, boondocks, swamp. But if we want to engage with such a realm in the future, it'll be a future life. With no more engagement with it in that way now, not this life, no more. All of that pushed into the future, in a future life, if we choose to exercise that option. This is the key to ascension, the key to ascension. This is how I see it. And it's that simple. It's really simple. Really, really simple. So what do we need to do? The boycotts. What are the boycotts? The boycotts. Boycotts. Think about it. The boycotts. The news. That's a great one right there, right? The news. The television. The internet. The movies. Right? Apple. The politics. The shopping. The sex. The drugs. And the music. Those are 10 boycotts. And for music, we're saying roll it back, nothing after 1969. Don't listen to anything after 1969, as far as music goes. And be careful what you listen to within that scope. But this is just a way to work on maybe the toughest addiction we have, really, which is music. I certainly have that addiction very bad. The musical addiction, of course, is very bad. So I have to be very, very careful on that one. I mean, I'm so musical, I could, you know, I can be completely immersed in it. Where everything is a song, everything is a symphony. Wherever I look, I can just, you know, I could just compose a song, a symphony. I guess the whole day can just be completely musical. But no, I have to stay away from that at this point, where our focus is ascension here. Because ultimately we're going toward effortlessness. And that's the real song. That's the real music. That is the real music. And so we're aiming to make that great. So the music of effort and turmoil really gets in the way. It pulls us back into that, which pulls us into trying to spiritualize delay. Very much it does. It says you got to, music is a very, very subtle and severe problem, because it gets used to, it pulls us into spiritualizing delay is what it does. So be very careful with that. Minimize it. Now, in boycotting, you do the best you can, right? You're committed to it. And you know, so if you happen, someone shoves, you know, people are very clever about trying to break down your determination, right? And if someone shoves something in your face and you glimpse something, you know, you just say, oh, wow, I need to get back. I'm boycotting. Please don't do that again, and get back to your boycott. It's like that. You don't fail just because someone shoves something in your face. So these are the boycotts. So we can do 10 boycotts to help us with ascension, help us towards ascension. It's very helpful. Very helpful, because we have to glimpse the utter simplicity of ascension, the great simplicity of it, of just postponing any more effort or struggle to a future life. And so then this one can be peaceful and smoothed out and blissful right now. Right now. And that right nowness is, we find ourselves in a higher realm where this is the way it is. We find ourselves in Arizonaville. A reduced intensity of my effort. Something like that. Of making effort, reduced intensity of making effort, a reduced intensity of making effort. Because remember, the dance we want to go to with this beautiful ballroom is effortless dance. You're dancing effortlessly. Who are the great dancers that people say, oh, you won the dance contest? The ones that seem to do it without any effort, like it's natural to them. It's just, I'm just naturally doing it. Just grace is natural. I don't need to make any effort. The ones that are all making all this effort, they seem awkward, don't they? Right, so we love this natural, oh, the natural. Like, we look like a baseball player just hits these home runs. It's like easy, easy. Remember, like Will Clark for the Giants, Will the Thrill. such a beautiful swing. It looked so easy, like he wasn't even trying. He wasn't even trying. We love that. It's like, oh, natural, no effort. So reduced intensity of making effort. Very much reduced effort, make effort, R-I-M-E, which happens to be also what the Tibetan Buddhist movement, R-I-M-E movement of, I believe that's what it is. I could be mistaken about that, but pure ecumenicalness here, pure ecumenicalness, no more spiritual conflict, right? Yeah. Of course, good luck with that in this world. This is where people come to make effort, which to be awkward, which produces conflict, of course. Futility. Why do you know, we got a scapegoat. Futility. You have to pursue this. To pursue effort, it feels futile. You have to project futility. Therefore, you have to scapegoat. It's impossible to have peace in such a realm. Completely impossible. Those who advocate that, they're just trying to spiritualize delay. That's all they're trying to do. Which is what matriarchy is so expert at. That's what it is here. That's what it is. It is what it is here. It is what it is. Just accept it. And say any future engagement with that will be a future life. Okay? Don't try to change the world. Just decide that whatever engagement you have with such a realm will be in a future life, but no more with this life. This is a secret to ascension. It's an open secret now. It's open advice now. Let this world be what it is. It is what it is. Okay? It's okay for it to be this way. It's perfectly okay for us to imagine effort and struggle and conflict and futility and try to seek for an absence of tally. It's perfectly okay. That too is just ornamentations of its own intrinsic spaciousness. It's perfectly okay. It is what it is. So don't try and make it something else. Just ascend. Just ascend. Okay? Very simple. Mistake everyone's making is try to change this world. Oh, we want a better world. This is our home. We got to make this house a home. No, we don't. We absolutely do not. Those who want a lower realms are absolutely entitled to those lower realms. In some future life, we may want those lower realms. Okay, so why should we want to change the world? Maybe sometime in a future life, we'll want a bunch of conflict. Experience that. Oh, they'll want to come down and struggle and conflict. Well, certainly they'll need to be such a realm to experience, right? Absolutely. But for the rest of this life, no more of that. Gone, evaporated, without a trace. Evaporated where? To a potential future life. Evaporated to a potential future life. A little cloud in the distance. That's where all this fog and mist is gone. It's now in that cloud in the future as a potential future life, if I want to exercise that option. That's where it went to. Chilly. It's still chilly, 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 chilly. Big difference between chilly and not chilly, isn't it? Is it really amazing? When it's not chilly, you feel it and say, ah, my clothes are not cold, I don't feel chilly, my feet, I like this. Whereas it's chilly, everything feels chilly. You can't escape it. Even if you eat hot chilies, you can't escape it. It's still chilly. It's still a cold chilly. Ooh. So it's hard to stay still. This is what's this chilly. So I feel a little bit better about myself. I really was in a crisis yesterday. But I stayed patient and kept praying and I really had to really have faith that the Holy Spirit would help out. Because I was turned around backwards. It was so tough. And now I feel much better. But, you know, how does it go forward? I don't know. The world is so... The stragglers are so nasty in what they do. They demand respect. Respect, well, I'll say, yeah, I'll respect it sometime in the, I might respect it sometime in the future. But show respect by showing, by coming here, well, yeah. And what they really mean is, well, delay. So anyway, you can't win. You can't win against them. You cannot win. You can't. This is something I have to understand. You cannot prevail here. But you can ascend. You can ascend. So I'm not trying to change the world and spiritualize this world. I'm focused on more on ascension. People come here to get drunk, really wiped out as far as spiritually drunk, to forget all about reality, to immerse themselves in human drama and suffering and all this nonsense. You know, they come here, it's like, you know, like a Mardi Gras of insanity, and they think they're curious about this, so the spiritual curiosity, they're perfectly free to do so, just as we're perfectly free to focus on what we're focusing on, and say any future engagement with that will, any engagement with that will be in the future life, not this life, not this body. It will be a future life, different body, different place, different life, not this body, not this life, not here now. That's all put into the future, as a all engagement with that is future life, if I choose to opt to exercise that option. I'm not saying I will or I won't. I have no position on that at this point whatsoever. I'm not saying I will, and I'm not saying I won't. But just see how it goes. And that's it. Okay, well, I don't want to just freeze out here. California, it's been a cold, cold winter. In December and January have been very cold. Which is fine, because we just came off of 4 years of like perpetual summer, which was actually very helpful to prepare for ascension. Very helpful indeed. I have to say that. Maybe that's why I'm living in California. Is the weather we had for the last 4 years, you couldn't ask for better weather. It's impossible here in this world. It was just, every day was just stunningly beautiful. So I'm more than grateful to California. For the experience here and the beauty of nature here and all of that. California has been really a great place to prepare for ascension. So I'm giving the love back to California. I've criticized the culture, the more recent culture, but I'm not criticizing the land, okay? This area of the planet. I'm not criticizing that at all. It is a fabulous, gorgeous place, now overrun with too many people and drought, etc. But that's not California's fault. And it's been a privilege to be here, a great privilege. And I could say more about that. I won't say it right now. But the weather, in the last 4 years, California, the weather, you have just been an absolute jewel. I did not have one complaint to make in the last 4 years. Every single day, I had no complaints whatsoever about the weather. It was just extraordinary. I felt like I'm in heaven almost, really. Like in a higher realm. It really felt like a higher realm. And this helps get us ready. So you see a lot of spiritual people in California throughout history, and they're aiming for ascension. There's a lot of ascensionists. They're aiming for ascension, and so one way or the other. But what I've done, I've smoothed it out a lot. I've done a lot of work just to smooth it all out. We aim to succeed here. Okay, this is not just, we're not just dilettantes here. And now we've had, you know, some weather the last couple months. It's been pretty unpleasant. You could still find some silver lining, I guess. It's been beautiful in a lot of ways, the clouds and stuff, but this chilliness is not pleasant. It's not. But California has always already done it, done its great work. And can I ask for a bonus, California? Can I ask you for a bonus? You know, cherry on top. Can you give us a cherry on top? You've been absolutely fabulous. Love you, love you, love you, California. Just best place on earth, in my opinion. Just every variety of flora and fauna. I mean, the you go here. There's so many microclimates in California, so many. And when that high pressure system, there's going to be a high pressure system coming in this next week. When it comes in, oh gosh, people like telling me, say, hey, I was down in Carmel last week, and you know, the Saturday, and so it was just so gorgeous. It just absolutely knocked me out. It was so gorgeous. Yeah. You know, 17-mile drive, you know, like that and stuff. Oh, wow. But the whole state is just, it reminds you of a higher realm. It really does. And that's why we don't like the fast-pacedness of it, that what's happened to the culture. We'd like to go slow here and enjoy it. Drive slowly. I like to drive slow because I like to soak it in. It's beautiful. It's very beautiful right now. It's always been very beautiful here. We're eager for ascension because the turmoil of this world, like the Super Bowl's coming here. This is a big bummer, you know, really. I mean, it, because just the threat level is just terrible here. We're just, you know, it's like keeping our fingers crossed that nothing happens, you know. And that's no way to live. That's not the California lifestyle, really. I don't know what happened in the news. I know there was something down south. Something happened. I don't know what happened. But it was very bad, let's put it that way. Somewhere in Riverside and San Bernardino, I guess. And I don't know what happened. I really don't. But it was some terrible situation happened that gave high feeling of threat level, you know, in California. We don't like that here. We really don't like that here. And that's not what California's for. So the Super Bowl coming here, it puts, you know, great threat level in this area, Bay Area, California. And we don't like that. We shouldn't have to keep our fingers crossed. Like, I mean, there's, you know, like, it's like what a, there's a certain percentage of possibility something could happen. And we don't like that. Nobody likes that. But we really don't like it here. Because this is just antithetical to our whole way of life here. Which is preparing for ascension. There's so many beautiful places in California where you just like marvel at it. I mean, I haven't even seen some of them. I haven't seen Laguna Beach and Newport Beach and San Diego, that area too much. Or in that Orange County, haven't seen too much of that. I mean, that's another, just Temecula and Santa Fe, I haven't seen those areas. Those are supposed to be just fabulous, beautiful, fabulous areas. The whole LA area is supposed to be fabulous. I haven't seen enough of that area at all. I haven't seen Santa Monica and Pacific Palo. I haven't seen those areas. Palos Verdes, no. But those are just gorgeous, gorgeous, gorgeous areas. So, but the whole state, the last 4 years, the weather has been like, you know, like San Diego weather, or it's just been perfect. As perfect as it can get. Only problem is no water, so it needs to recharge the water banks a little bit here, but not, you know, this ascension is coming soon. The way I see it, it's coming soon. So it's done its great work. But now if I can just ask California, just, can you do, just, you know, put the cherry on top for me, please. Put the cherry, and you drive around, you see all these citrus trees right now. All so many yards have these beautiful citrus trees, and they're just loaded with citrus. Just, we're talking about thousands. I mean, the orange trees are just absolutely stuffed. The lemon trees, the tangerine trees, the various citrus trees all over the place are absolutely just a sight to behold. Thousands. hundreds of oranges and tangerines, thousands of tangerines. It was beautiful. It was very beautiful. You just walk around. Oh, wow. Look at that. Wow. So, from one standpoint, I've enjoyed California. The other, to see it being get run down has been very, very upsetting. It's been very difficult to deal with. The crime that has come here, the overcrowding, and then the fast-paced lifestyle, the pricing of everything, the whole pace of life, just the intensity of the aggravation, all this stuff has been very, very difficult to take. We like to just stop and talk. And basically, you're in such a beautiful place, you see someone, you just smile, you kind of wave like, yeah, isn't this lovely? And they say, yeah, this is fabulous, I'm enjoying it. Aren't we enjoying it? Yeah, we are. You know, this is just wow. And the beaches, everything is just wow, we're really enjoying this. And you just kind of enjoy it together. That's California. California is just, we're enjoying our state together. This is how it should be. This is the feeling we should have. This is the feeling we used to have. And this is what's kind of been dissipated, unfortunately. But as the frantic competition for money, just is so expensive here. You know, and so many people have come, so many Asians have come here, and they're so intensely competitive, like in schools. They want to be rich, 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 rich. And you know, for us, native Californians, you know, no, that's not it at all. We just want to enjoy California. That's all. That's all we want, because it's something we know. We know it's preparing us for something better. So, I'm putting out the love for California. It's time to do that. Boy, have I been immersed in the beauty of California. Salinas Valley, there's another place, very beautiful. I was immersed in Salinas Valley for about 3 years. Paro Valley, you know, the Monterey Peninsula, Central Coast, Central Valley, the Sierras. You go on and on and on, the coastal mountains, North Bay, you know, the Northern California, the coastal area. The Big Sur area, then Coachella Valley, you know, you just go Eastern Sierra. It goes on and on and on and on and on. Mojave Desert, oh God, beautiful. You know, entire Southern California, LA area, the Bay Area, of course, is gorgeous. Yeah, it is. Absolutely gorgeous. And, it's just, you know, you can't miss. Wine country is gorgeous. And then tourists come from all over the world to California. Just, you know, there's so much beauty to see here. Yeah, native Californians, we've been immersed in it our whole life, immersed in it, as well as our parents, some of us, yeah, right, immersed in it, goes back generations. So we don't want this, you know, competitiveness in schools and academia and all this. It's just nasty now. It's hideous. I talk to people in it and they say, it's just cutthroat. It is just so intense. And a lot of people are having depression and suicide and all sorts of problems. Students, because they don't really want to do that. They want to enjoy. So the last 4 years, California has given us this great bloom. It's awesome bloom at its very best. And the weather, you just go outside and it's enough. You just like you drink it in. It's enough. Wherever you are, it's enough. Just the weather was enough. That's how good it was. I don't really care where I was. It didn't really matter. I just said, wow, can't beat this. You just cannot beat it in this world. So I keep harping on this. I keep harping on it for some reason. It's important. So you might say that the realm we can ascend to is like California, except way better, without any of the problems, you know? Way better, way more beautiful without any of the problems. You could say it that way. Yeah, you really could. That's a very good analogy to use, like it's like that. And without any of the worldly problems either that we're used to suffering from. Ascension is very doable. We've been told this over and over and over. There's been a huge push for ascension over the last 60 years here in this world. Huge push. Many, many, many people have spoken about ascension. And we've been saying, can we do this? Can we do this? Because we realize that this is a nice option to exercise coming up here, because the world certainly, we know it's going towards turmoil. We know it. I mean, if you really look at the world, ask yourself, in the near future, are we really going to be free of all these troubles we have right now? Are we going to wake up tomorrow and there's no more radical Islam in the world going around bombing stuff? Is that going to vanish tomorrow? Wake up, it's gone. There's no possibility of that. There's no possibility of it. Technology. Or wake up tomorrow and technology has vanished. There's no possibility of that. Or wake up tomorrow, no one's going to be using smartphones. There's no possibility of that. Wake up tomorrow, no more movies. Impossible. No more TV. Impossible. It's not going to happen. No more bad news. The news is a wake up tomorrow that no more news. You know, it's all good. Impossible. Wake up tomorrow. Pharmaceuticals. No more pharmaceutical advertisements and pressure to use. Impossible. On and on and on. The tensions in the world. Are we going to wake up tomorrow and all this stuff is gone? In the near future? What? Tomorrow? Next day? A year from now? 10 years? 20 years? Vulnerability being hacked? Our identity? Is hacking going to disappear in like 20 years? It's no more. Everyone's going to be great. No more fear of identity theft. I mean, the Hyatt had they were hacked. Hyatt was hacked. And our credit card information, everything was part of what was hacked. Okay? Is that going to vanish in 20 years? 10 years? 5? Tomorrow? We used our credit card in a restaurant, Hyatt restaurant, during the time when that information was hacked, and they got. Oh, so we have to look at that, and we're worried and we're concerned, right? Is that going to vanish? Wake up in the morning and we're not going to be concerned about money, and losing money. What, 5 years from now, 10 years, 20, the rest of my life? How old am I? Going to be 60, so maybe I'll live to be 90. Let's say in these days you might live to be 90. 30 more years. In 30 years, is all these problems are going to be gone? Technology is going to vanish from this world in 30 years? I don't think so. I don't think so. In fact, there's about zero, the odds are about zero on that and that happening. So, we're going to have turmoil here. Are the Jews and the Arabs going to become like absolute smoothed out best friends forever in the next 30 years? Pakistanis and the Indians, is that going to happen? Chinese and freedom loving Americans, is that going to happen? Is it all just one love fest? Really? Materialism is going to vanish? Aggressive telemarketing is going to vanish, advertising, pharmaceuticals, all this. No, no, no. All the stuff for boycotting is going to be gone tomorrow. Wake up tomorrow, it's gone. No. Look at this. There's zero possibility of that. Zero possibility of this stuff happening. It's not going to happen in the next 30 years. The way it's trending, you know, the way the generations have been conditioned, it's not going to happen. Is everyone going to turn away from technology and say, no, our entire economy, the whole global economy, all money, everything's run by computers. It's all going to be, is roboticism going to disappear? Everyone's going to, no, it's becoming more and more and more and more. So this world is trending in a terrible direction. And the likelihood it's going to stop trending that way is virtually nil. Virtually nil. So it would be astonishingly foolish to not consider ascension. I don't want to spend the next 30 years of my life waking up in the morning with all these terrible trends. Who does? Who does? Who does? So if we can ascend, by all means, let's ascend. By all means, let's ascend. And let those who want this nastiness here, let them have their little fun here. Let them have their Mardi Gras revelry if they want to. Let them have their turmoil. That's fine. But let us ascend. So I'm going to ask California for some more help here. I really am. Because I have a very deep connection with California. I have very much appreciated it. Not the modern culture that's invaded, but very much appreciated. I understood what it's for. And California's given me some beauty that touches upon the higher realms. It really has. I put those in some videos I've done here. I put a lot of videos out. And that, I got the vibe. I got, it feels like an echo, a faint echo of the higher realm. It really has done that. So here's the exercise. Wherever you are, if where you are is really giving you a lot of love in terms of preparing you, you know, give some gratitude towards it and ask it, can you put the cherry on top for me right now? So there's a lot of advice here. I said, go to a golf resort. Even if you don't play golf, that's okay. Just hang out there and experience hospitality. We need to experience great hospitality right now. Five star. You know, just because this hotel's five star doesn't mean you'll get five star hospitality. You have a better opportunity for that, but it's not necessarily. You need to be treated like you're really an owner of the place, and they're just there to be invisible. If you want to be invisible, they're invisible, and if you want some help, they're there to help, and that's great hospitality. They don't press solicitousness upon you, you know. They don't press it upon you at all. If you just want to walk around, there's nobody's going to be looking at you walking around, taking pictures. Man, you are a celebrity. You're the boss there. You're the owner. They're just happy to make your stay there pleasant. That thrills them. They're thrilled to do that. This is called great hospitality. So we want a great place, great hospitality, boycott. Focus on ascension, how easy it is. This is all now the pots that we have on the stove, right? We got the flame on these pots, and we're cooking. We're cooking up a great meal here. Most people know how to cook. This is a great metaphor. You're cooking a meal, and you've got certain dishes that are in the pans and the pots, and you got the flame on them, and you're cooking. And this is going to end up being, you're going to put together a great meal from this. So that's what we're doing. The gratitude, you know, the boycott the stuff. Have the gratitude for the preparation you've been given. Realize how simple ascension is. Go to a great place that's got a tremendous amount of, where you've experienced tremendous hospitality. And also go to a really beautiful place too. And the people around at the place are important. I find these really top golf resorts have a very, everybody there is like kind of a professional, they're sort of professional. They're not into drunken revelry and that kind of stuff so much. You know, if you're a golfer, you're going there to golf, and you want to be sober as can be. And you're there to appreciate the quiet and the peace and the calm and the whole atmosphere of it. Not all golfers are that way. Okay, there are some that are hackers that like get drunk on the golf course, and I stay away from those. But by and large, they're a pretty sober group of people who are relaxed and enjoy around a golf. You relax, you enjoy the aesthetics of it. They're nice people. Talking to golfers, usually I've always experienced they're very nice people, friendly people actually. They know, you know, how to enjoy. So here is some good advice here, and we can pretty much wrap this up here at some point. This looks like it's going to go longer than expected, which is nice. It's only 3 gigabytes, which means I could go for another hour, but I'm getting kind of cold. California Dreamin'. That was a song of the 60s, Mamas and the Papas. All the leaves are brown and the sky is gray. I went out for a walk on a winter's day. I'd be safe and warm if I was in L.A., California dreaming on such a winter's day. Walked into a church, and I began to pray. I pretend to pray. You know the preacher likes the cold. He knows we're going to stay, California dreaming on such a winter's day. Walked into a church I saw along the way. I got down on my knees and I pretend to pray. You know the preacher likes the cold, 'cause he knows we're gonna stay, California dreaming on such a winter's day. I think produced by Lou Adler in, what was it, Gold Studios, Western or Gold. It was either Capitol, Western or Gold, one of those three LA studios, with the Wrecking Crew. Which is the studio musicians just kicking it back then. Awesome. Mamas and Papas had some really good records. It was like really high quality production and sound and everything. Just a lot of those groups, you know, recorded in LA back then was just the best. The Beach Boys, I mean, listening to the songs of 69, top 100 songs, I think deck 90, number 95, number 94, 95 was I Can Hear Music by the Beach Boys with Carl Wilson singing the lead. I think Brian was in rehab. He's having trouble with drugs at that time. If I were to do the list of the top songs of 1969, I put that song at the very top, I Can Hear Music, at the very top. That's number one, because as I made this playlist, I was listening to every single song of top songs of 1969, and I can tell you, when I got to that song, I Can Hear Music, immediately I said, wow, that's the best one. It was noticeable. It was more beautiful, and the production, oh my gosh, the harmony of the Beach Boys at that time on that song, and the sound and they got from the studio, just amazing. It was noticeably better than everything else. So I put that number one. I Can Hear Music. I Can Hear Music by the Beach Boys. Listen to that song. And the harmony is so tight, so clean, and so well produced. Just wow, we haven't got anything better since then, I tell you the truth. We really have not. I mean, I think the Beach Boys really was the peak of music in terms of the overall sound that they were able to achieve. I mean, everything was analog tube, magnetic tape. the Neumann recorders, the tube recorders they were using, the microphones, I mean, Neumann microphones, and the echo chambers they're using at what, Gold Studio? They might have recorded Gold or Western, but the reverb chambers they hasn't been beat since, really. It's just fabulous the way they did it. He invented, I think, the Gold man who owned Gold Studios invented the reverb chamber like that. And the genius of Brian Wilson producing, et cetera, and the musicians, the Wrecking Crew, has not been surpassed, and probably not even equaled since then. Probably not even equaled. I think the music back then has not been equaled since. It's been in severe decline. The Rolling Stones are very, very good at that time. Led Zeppelin, I mean, even those heavier rock stuff. I mean, listening to this production on the Rolling Stones and the musicianship, it's extraordinary. Very extraordinary. They were very good at that time. With Keith Richards, you know, doing the rhythm and whoever else was playing. I mean, they were very talented at that time. But there was a lot of talented groups then. Chicago was playing then with the brass. I mean, just listen to the music of 69 and you'll hear a lot of tremendous music. But I can hear music. Wow. Dun, 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 dun. This is the way I always dreamed it would be, the way that it is. Oh, when, like that. That's Carl Wilson of the Beach Boys. It's not Brian, it's Carl singing that. Brian did the falsetto higher singing on the earlier Beach Boys songs, but he took too much LSD and drugs trying to become super creative, and he crashed like a Led Zeppelin. He lost it. You know, he was Icarus. Brian Wilson was Icarus. He flew too close to the sun. And I kind of crashed with him because I was on that ride with him. And you know, when the Beach Boys kind of struggled there, because, you know, I really, it's like the music died, and I was so immersed in music, it's like I died, went down the tubes with them, went down the drain with them, because they were really the banner carriers for me, I mean, for music. The Beatles are really great, but they couldn't match the sound of the Beach Boys. They really could not. The Beatles are very creative, very innovative, very culturally innovative, you would say. Very culturally clever. And of course, George Harrison was awesome, and Paul McCartney's was awesome music talent, And and Lennon was very cheeky and clever. But the Beach Boys sound just blows the Beatles away. Still does. Still does. And in that list of songs of 69, keep in mind that the Beatles songs have been removed from YouTube. Suddenly. It happened just a little while ago. All of them, they're all gone. Wow. So I had to include Beatles songs, and I had to include, like, bootleg stuff or stuff for that somehow slipped through the cracks of this dragnet, that this massive dragnet. I don't know who controls Beatle catalog or whatever, but they decided to yank all Beatles songs off YouTube. Poof, gone. Well, no, see, you talk about turmoil in the world. You think, oh, what a great place the world is. I can go on YouTube and listen to all these Beatles songs. It's awesome. Next, you wake up the next morning, they're all gone. How friendly a world is that? It is a great, great example. I understand that people love the Beatles. I love the Beatles too. I mean, they made great music.